Thank you for tuning in to another episode of InRange. This is a difficult topic today, and the footage you're going to see was filmed 4 years ago. Yes, 4 years ago. And the reason I've been sitting on this video content is because I haven't been sure when I could publish it. The reality is that I've been waiting for an opportunity to publish this video in which it would not be seen in the light of the current situation or current events, because people would think that I'm publishing this in response to a current event. And the reality is there's never been a chance in 4 years to publish this video where it wouldn't be seen as a commentary on a current event. So I'm going to give up on that idea because it's never going to happen, and I'm going to publish it because I think it's important to be published. One of the topics that I, Carl, cover here on InRangeTV are issues of historical significance that I believe are intentionally left out of the general population's narrative, culturally lost, whether it is Old West or modern, things that have been intentionally left off of the general understanding is something that I believe should be brought to light, because it's those topics that really give us insight into society, whether it's historical or current. And the one that I'm covering today is about the murder of a number of innocent and unarmed civilians on Danziger Bridge, September 4th, 2005, just a few days after Hurricane Katrina. And while you are inevitably going to paint this in the light of whatever current event is going on today, whether you're watching it right now in May of 2020 or watching it in November of 2025, I have an unsettling feeling that there'll be something going on in this country that will make you think that this video was published in response to that, and that is not the case. I also am going to dub in moments through this video, things that I have been able to find out more after the fact and hopefully correct the narrative. The other thing that I do want you to understand is that this is wholly my work. This is my work. I run InRangeTV, and I decided to do this topic because I felt it was important. This video is not intended to give you any specific view. It is intended to be an historical account as accurately as I can represent it, and it is wholly my work and does not represent anyone else that's ever been on InRangeTV. This video is my work and my work wholly. Danziger Bridge, New Orleans, Louisiana, September 4th, 2005, just after 9 a.m., a budget rental truck drives up to this bridge. Plainclothes police officers jump out of the vehicle and open fire with M4 carbines and one Kalashnikov rifle, killing two unarmed civilians and heavily wounding a majority of the Bartholomew family before they took cover. On August 23, 2005, Hurricane Katrina formed in the Gulf. It became as large as a Category 5 hurricane, which is about as big as they get, but by the time it got to New Orleans, it had downgraded to a Category 3, with 130 mile-an-hour sustained winds, or 200 kilometers per hour. Before the storm actually got to the city, Mayor Ray Nagin ordered a mandatory evacuation order. Most people tried to comply with the mandatory evacuation order, but the reality is not everyone in New Orleans had the capabilities to do so. They either did not have their own transportation, or they lived below the poverty line, and the reality of being able to leave the city was completely infeasible. On top of that, the city did not provide sufficient public transportation to help those people leave the city. So the reality is the majority of people that stayed behind in Katrina were there not necessarily because they chose to, but because they couldn't choose not to be. Catastrophic engineering and design failures in the levee system designed to keep New Orleans dry during a hurricane like this resulted in levee failures across the city. The city flooded in many places, most significantly the Lower Ninth Ward, which is one of the more economically challenged parts of the community, meaning that the people that lived in the Lower Ninth Ward had very little chance or opportunity to leave and flee this storm, even based on Mayor Ray Nagin's mandatory evacuation order. As a result, many families had no choice but to shelter in place. Some of them stuck in their homes with rising floodwaters, having to hack their way to the roof to not drown in their own homes with an axe. Many people were thrust out of their destroyed homes and had no choice but to live outside exposed to the elements. No food, no resources, no supplies. And while the news tended to like to focus on the idea that there were looters all over New Orleans, the reality is the majority of these people were strictly looking for food and water to try and survive in the sweltering heat. In this video today covering this incident, we're going to discuss two families. The Madison brothers, who were stranded in New Orleans, also looking for supplies and were at the top of the bridge when the NOPD drove up, and the Bartholomew family, along with a friend, who were living literally behind a concrete barrier in an attempt to shelter themselves from the elements. They were walking down the bridge to East New Orleans in an attempt to get some water and food and supplies, and the Madison brothers were doing the same.
A little before 9 a.m., an NOPD convoy is going over the I-10 overpass, and they call in that they're receiving gunfire from the local vicinity and insinuate that there's a downed officer on the Danziger Bridge.
So the convoy actually did hear gunfire, but it was not gunfire directed at them. It was gunfire from people who were stranded in flooded buildings or flooding buildings as distress calls, hopefully trying to find someone to come rescue them. So they heard gunfire, but the accounts of that gunfire being targeted at them and the account of a downed officer on Danziger Bridge were both incorrect.
The Bartholomew family and one friend, James Brissett, are walking over the bridge with a shopping cart in an attempt to find supplies, water, and food 6 days after the flood. A budget rental truck arrives at the base of Danziger Bridge, directly behind the Bartholomew family. Plainclothes officers jump out of the truck, saying that they're engaged in gunfire. They open fire with M4 carbines and at least one Kalashnikov variant, striking the Bartholomew family immediately. Susan Bartholomew is hit multiple times. Her right arm hit so severely she said it's held on by a piece of meat and later amputated. James Bridgette is hit multiple times and dies immediately at the scene. The youngest of the Bartholomew family jumps under the bridge and gets away uninjured. Those who are still alive jump over the concrete embankment in an attempt to get away from the fusillade of gunfire. It is right about here that the Bartholomew family and James Brissett are engaged with gunfire from the plainclothes police officers exiting the unmarked budget rental truck. James Brissett is killed right here on the freeway, hit 7 times with rifle fire. The Bartholomew family are all hit with gunfire except for Leonard Bartholomew IV, who jumps off the side of the bridge, runs underneath, and escapes. The rest of them jump over this concrete embankment on this pedestrian walkway in an attempt to escape the fusillade of gunfire. The police officers believe this threat to have been neutralized. After effectively neutralizing the Bartholomew family and friend at the base of the bridge, they see the Madison brothers up here, who start running after hearing the gunfire at the crest of the bridge. They get back into the budget rental truck and drive up to the crest of the bridge to pursue them. Falcon, Hunter, and Gasevius exit the vehicle and enter an unmarked police vehicle pursuing Lance and Ronald Madison, brothers, who are trying to escape the gunfire that erupted on the other side of the bridge. They are escaping on foot down this side of the bridge. Gasevius, Falcon, and Hunter are in the car pursuing them. Falcon extends a shotgun out the back of the car and fires one round, hitting Ronald Madison in the back with at least 5 projectiles. Ronald Madison is somewhere around here, runs into this parking lot, collapses here, where he later passes away. Another officer, Bowen, was charged with stomping him in the back in his wounded state. However, that was later overturned due to lack of physical evidence. Right here is where Ronald Madison died, passed away at what was then called the Friendly Inn, now called the Royal Inn of New Orleans. His brother Lance was arrested moments later and held in prison for 3 weeks with no indictment before he was let go. Directly across from the Danziger Bridge is the I-10 overpass. Some news crews actually heard the gunfire, the first fusillade, and started filming in this direction and caught some of the budget rental truck and the officers with their rifles on Danziger Bridge, right about here at the crest.
So this shooting happened in September of 2005. It takes 2 years for indictments to come down on the officers involved in these shootings. They're charged with murder and attempted murder. But in 2008, the charges are dropped. 5 years after these people are killed, another trial occurs because there's evidence of a cover-up that has been revealed. And in this, we find out that homicide detective Arthur Kaufman is found guilty of concealing and creating evidence to justify the shooting. And we even find out that NOPD Lieutenant Michael Lohman encouraged his officers to carry and use drop guns to plant at the scene of a shooting in which they shot an unarmed civilian. The officers are ultimately charged and sentenced quite stringently for these shootings that occurred in 2005. Two years later, in 2012, there's a retrial, and these officers immediately plead guilty for lesser charges. And you're going to see in this chart that the lesser charges they receive are lesser indeed. The reason I do this video isn't to reopen old wounds, it's because there's constant wounds going on, and I said in the introduction to this video that I was holding on to this footage for 4 years in an attempt to release it when it wouldn't be considered something in response to a current event. But in the time I filmed this 4 years ago and now, there hasn't been an opportunity to do that. And that to me says that I just have to release it, and there isn't going to be an opportunity to do that. So hopefully you have found this to be enlightening, interesting, and informative. And the reason I release a video like this is because, one, I don't want history to be forgotten in this country, whether it's Old West or modern, and also to remember the names of those lost in incidents like this, because that list is getting longer and longer every day. Thank you for watching.